So section 14 prescribes that the property of the female possessed by her is no more a limited owner but an absolute property. So as we already know that absolute property is nothing but it has all the rights. So absolute ownership is nothing but he can alienate the property by means of sale, gift, anything he wants. There is no restrictions. But in limited and life estate, there is a restriction. Before this act, whenever a property passes to the males, son, 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 the property is absolute property. But in case of females, it was limited estate. But this provision, section 14, says that it is no more a limited estate. The property hereafter will be an absolute property. There are two concepts, limited estate and life estate. So life estate and limited estate, both the rights stops when the after the death of the limited estate or life estate holder. But after their death, unlike the absolute property, it won't pass to the heirs of the life estate or limited estate holder. Instead, if it passes to the absolute owner, then it is called life estate. And if it passes to the heirs of the last male holder, then it is called limited estate. These are the two key differences. So let's see how the limited estate works with an example. Let's say a Hindu male F dies intestate, survived by his wife, widow, and his daughter. So now the last male holder is F because he is the male and he is holding the property as an absolute owner. So F is the last male holder. So after his death, the heir would be his wife. So his wife, since she is a female, the property shall go to his widow and she will hold it as an limited estate. So after her death, the property will go to the heirs of the last male holder. As I say, last male holder now in this case is F only, because F is the absolute owner. So F's heir is again the daughter of. So the daughter will take the property after the widow's death. Since she is a female, she will again hold it as a limited owner only. Assume the daughter has the daughter, has the son. So after daughter's death, the son will get the property as an absolute owner because he is a male. So he will take as an absolute owner and now he will become the last male holder. So now daughter's son will become as a last male holder. So after his death, after daughter's son's death, the property will go to heirs of the last male holder. Now it is daughter's son. So daughter's son's heir will take the property and not heirs of F. Hope you understood. This is how the limited estate works. So in one of the provisions, they have mentioned that the properties which I have listed over here, either by partition, inheritance, or by her own skill, or if gift from any person, or Sridhana property, maintenance, or in any other manner, whatever it is, it will be considered as a absolute property and not a limited owner. So there is another proviso in section 14, subsection 2. It stated that if there is any term that has been mentioned in will, gift, decree, or award, which states that only restricted estate is applicable, then only that is applicable and not the absolute property. For example, if the father makes a will to her daughter that she will hold the property as a life estate, and after her death the children of the property will take it as an absolute owner, then only the life estate would be applicable for the daughter, and after her death the children of the daughter will take it as an absolute ownership. Since it is mentioned in the clause of the will, then only that is applicable and not the section 14(1). So if there is no will, gift, degree, or award, and if there is no term of restricted estate, only the absolute property will be possessed by the female. So section 15 prescribes how the female's property has to be distributed. Totally it has 5 entries. The first entry would be children and husband. If there are no one in the first entry, then the property will distribute to the heirs of the husband. If first and second entry people are not there, then it will devolve upon mother and father. If they are also not there, fourthly it is heirs of the father, and lastly it is the heirs of the mother. So this rule varies from where she inherits the property, that we will see in section 15.2. Suppose a female Hindu inherits the property from her father or mother. In absence of their children, it will go to heirs of the father. And if she inherits from her father-in-law and in absence of her children, then it will go to heirs of the husband. From these two provisions, we can say that if she possesses self-acquired property, then section 15.1 is applicable. And if she inherits property from father, mother or husband or her father-in-law, then section 15.2 is applicable. So section 16 prescribes three rules which tells about the order of succession and manner of distribution. In rule number 1, it states that the one entry shall be preferred to those in any succeeding entry. That is, the first entry will always be given preference when compared to the subsequent entry. Only when there are no people in first entry, the people in the second entry will get the property. Then in rule 2, the predeceased son or daughter will take the property on behalf of their parents. In rule number 3, they have mentioned that if the property has to devolve upon the heirs of her husband or father or her mother, we have to consider it as their own property. Suppose if it has to devolve upon her heirs of the mother, then section 15 is applicable. Suppose if the property is devolved upon the heirs of the father or husband, then section 8 is applicable because they are males. So section 17 says that if the persons who were governed by Marmiki Chimla is no more governed by that law, but now it, since this act had been passed, it will be applicable to those persons as well, with some changes in section 8. Section 15 and section 15 2a and 23 is omitted for them, and in section 8 c and d we've already seen if there are no class 1 and class 2 heirs, it will go to agnates, and if there are no agnates, then only it will go to cognates. But here in this provision they have said that if there are no class 1 class 2 heirs, it will go either to agnates or cognates. Accordingly, in section 15 they have made some changes. First entry we have seen as children and husband, but here in this case the first entry is children and mother, secondly to father and husband, thirdly to heirs of the husband, fourthly to heirs of the mother, and lastly the heirs of the mother. So with these changes, it is applicable to the persons who were governed by Marumakettiyam or Alasindanala.